Namaskaram to all. Welcome to the 25th session of the Vande Guru Paramparam series. On this very special session, we have a very special guest with us for the Sambhashanam. It's none other than the well-known exponent of Mohiniyattam, a musician and scholar, Dr. Deepthi Omcheri Malla. Deepthi ma'am, welcome to the Sambhashanam series. Dr. Deepthi Omcheri Malla, a very well-known exponent of Mohiniyattam, which she learned from the legendary late Kalamandalam Kanyamukuti Amma, has contributed much in expanding and enhancing the Mohiniyattam repertoire and style, as also presenting this dance form in multiple national and international forums. She has won many awards, including the Kendra Sangeetha Natak Academy, the Kerala Sangeetha Natak Academy Award. But that's not it. He donned so many hats: a singer, a dancer, teacher, researcher, scholar, many more. In fact, if you go through her resume, it's actually graduation, PG, MPhil and PhD in Carnatic music. And she actually heads the Department of Music at the Delhi University currently. She's a gold medalist from the University of Delhi in Carnatic music, and she also topped the university in MPhil. She also learned Kathakali under veteran gurus like the late Kunnathur Madhava Padikar, late Guru Gopinath, late Sadanam Nandakumar, Nelliyodu Vasudevan Nambudiri, Sadanam Balakrishnan. And over the last few decades, along with her mother, the great scholar and musician, Dr. Leela Omcheri Ma'am, she has been doing intense research in the traditional music of Kerala. Ma'am, we are really privileged to have you in the Sambhashanam series today.
Thank you.
Now, to start off with, the term Mohiniyattam, could you tell us something about how this term came about and something about the origin and evolution of this dance form of Mohiniyattam?
I'll just briefly describe about or explain about the, I would not go much deep into the historical background, because what we know for sure is the period of Renaissance or the period of revival in 1930. Till before,
slightly high, I guess.
Should I reduce that?
Yeah, if you could slightly reduce the Shruti. Yes, ma'am, this is okay. Sorry, ma'am, you were saying
that. I was saying that going too deep into the historical background of origin of Mohiniyattam will take a lot of time. And I'd rather start with the period of Renaissance. That was the revival period in 1930. Because we know it was from that period when my guru, Kalamandalam Kalyanikutty Amma, went there, was enrolled as a student of the first guru there, Krishna Padityarasa. And so she was the one who has bridged the gap between the period of Renaissance and its further development. So for me, that 1930 period is very important, because only after that, Kalyanikutty Amma, being a literate dancer, and also she was young as compared to her contemporaries who were past their prime age, 70, 75. She could contribute, and she had that passion to know about Mohiniyattam, and she wanted to develop the art form as best as she could, because it was lying in a very fragmented condition. When Vallathol and Mukundaraja actually tried to bring back the exponents who had drifted to different corners of Kerala region, to bring them under one common roof, especially when during its period of decline it had lost its status. So to bring them, all these dancers and exponents, together under one roof and once again revive this almost lost form was a big achievement for these two connoisseurs. And even though it was revived, still it was in a very completely disoriented and fragmented shape. It had no shape and structure. So whatever little was given and whatever little Kalyanipati Amma learned from her gurus, she further expanded it, giving it a particular a proper format, technique and a repertoire, which till then there was some repertoire, but not in a kind of a margam. It was not there as a kind of a margam. And many of Kalyanipati Amma's disciples, who are now even retired, some of them are no longer alive, some of them have retired from Kalamandalam, they all have learned from her and they have further expanded and developed that art form to such a level that now Mohiniyattam, one can say with surety and with pride, that it has reached a level of national and international popularity. So it's thanks to the original gurus and teachers and students, disciples who had enrolled themselves in Kalamandalam. So when I started learning from her, obviously after 12 years of Kathakali, it was very, very difficult for me to switch over to such a graceful and a soft flowing kind of a style where every expression had to be so subtle and restrained. It was very difficult for me to do that changeover. But Kalyanipati Amma helped me by helping me analyze these, how to do the drishtis, how to control the facial expressions, how to control the body movements. She taught me in just, I think, a couple of years that I used to go and learn from her. First from in Trivandrum when she was coming, and later when she became very old and sick, I used to go to Tripunithara, stay at her daughter's place, Srimati Kala Vijayan, who is also a very well-known teacher and who taught a couple of Padavarnams and Padams also to me. So learning there under Kalyanipati Amma, for the first time I realized that Mohiniyattam is not just a sensual and erotic and enchanting dance form, as many people at that time, you know, had sort of connected it with. But it is far beyond that. Like all the art forms of Kerala predominantly have an underlying essence of Satvika Abhinaya. There is a Sattva Guna there. Most all the art forms, if you take Kudiyattam, if you take Kathakali, there is an underlying essence of Satvika Abhinaya. So taking from that, the Satvika Abhinaya became the prime and the pillar of Mohiniyattam. So whatever expressions that came out of it had an underlying sattva bhava. So whether it was Shringara, whether it was Ayanaka, Bhibatsa, Raudra, everything could not be expressed boldly and aggressively as I had learned in Kathakali, or as one could express through Kathakali, or maybe Kudiyattam and Nangiyarput. There also the expressions are, of course, they are very graceful, but there is a different style of presentation. Here you will find that Mohiniyattam, there was a blend of Lokadharmi, Natyadharmi. And even in Lokadharmi, you could not go beyond a certain limit, a kind of a parameter beyond which you could not jump over those parameters, because you were addressing a Nayaka Nayaka through the God and the Bhakta relationship. You were trying to project that. So when you projected that kind of a relationship, it was essential for you to restrain your movements and control your expressions. So every kind of bhava, Kalyanipati Amma used to actually look at me and correct me how to do it, you know. So that was a big blessing that I had from her. And in fact, when I went to her in 1978, that was the time I went to her. She took me perhaps under her tutelage immediately. Firstly, probably because I had 12 years of Kathakali training, but also she was an ardent admirer of my mother. She had great admiration and respect for my mother, because my mother was a regular contributor of articles in many of the leading publications and magazines, Malayalam magazines of Kerala, which Kalyanipati Amma was all the time reading. She, you, any time that you went to her house, Kalyanikutty Amma would have at least 2-3 magazines with her, and she would be, you know, constantly reading. So because of that, she had a kind of an attachment and affection towards me. And the first item that she taught me was not Cholkattal. You know, like generally in an art form, the moment you learn the Adavus, the first is the Allarikora Cholkat or something that with which you learn the all the movements. But here right. She did not teach me the Cholkat. She started off with a Padam, Yendahu Vandapa.
Wow.
So, and in that Yendahu Vandapa, I learned so much. I mean, I did not realize that Padam could be so difficult, not only to sing, as you are a singer yourself, you have learned. So you would know how difficult it is to sing that musical form. It is equally difficult to enact, to express the sentiments. Because there are so many Sanchari Bhavas in that. To choose those Sanchari Bhavas and Vyabhichari Bhavas, you have to have some kind of a sensitivity towards the Sthayi Bhava there. And if you are sensitive about the Sthayi Bhava that the Padam is projecting, as the underlying essence of a Padam, only then you can do the improvisation with the Sanchari Bhava. So all these things I learned from her and developed myself later on as I grew matured as a dancer.
Great, ma'am. Ma'am, you mentioned about Kathakali, right? You yourself have learned Kathakali. And of course, it is one of the traditional dance forms in Kerala. Do you, ma'am, can you explain a bit about, like, was there any mutual give and take between the mudras that is used in Mohiniyattam versus that is used in Kathakali, or was it also, did it also take a bit from the Bharatanatyam dance form which was there in the Tamil Nadu? How did these all evolve together?
As far as the Hasta mudras are concerned, it has not taken, except for a few mudras from Abhinaya Darpana, which Bharatanatyam also adopts. All the Hasta mudras that Mohiniyattam has adopted is from Hastalakshana Deepika, which is what Kathakali is, the main text, hand gesture text for Kathakali. And which is very natural because the hand gestures, when it was, you know, during the period of revival, Vallathol and Mukundaraja wanted to the style to develop in context to the regional styles of Kerala. So that was very important, and perhaps because of that, they took up the Hastalakshana Deepika gestures. They took up certain Tiruvadira Kaikoti Kali, you know, which were the folk forms of that, some movements from there. That could be one of the reasons that they tried to introduce all these things, which were already existing and a part of the Kerala culture. So as far as the Hastas are concerned, it's Hastalakshana Deepika. The movements, when I learned from Kalyanikutty Amma, if you see her formatting, her technique and the adavus that she designed, it is very natural because Mohiniyattam was a southern nritya which was popularized in the court of Maharaja Swati Tirunal, Kartika Tirunal and Swati Tirunal, where southern nritya, which is now Bharatanatyam, was already popular. So, and it was patronized by the Travancore Maharajas, based on which they wanted to have a female dance form, which they named as Mohiniyattam, or whatever name that it had. Mohini Nattanam also was given by Kartika Tirunal. So they wanted to have a female dance form which was exclusively that belonged to the region of Kerala. But what had happened here was, except for the Cholkat, which is different from Allariku, the other repertoire items in the repertoire, like Padam, Padavarnam, Japiswaram, Tillana, everything, Shlogam, everything was a part of the repertoire in the Satyam Nritya. So when Kalyanikutty Amma devised the technique and wrote down, it was very natural that many of these movements and techniques had some reflection of the Satyam Nritya, which people, I would say, who did not know much about Mohiniyattam, and because it had not developed so much at that time, they tried to compare it with the Bharatanatyam or a Kuchipudi or whatever, which had already grown very popular and people had knew about it, you know.
Right.
So there was this danger of a comparison between an art form which had its own distinctiveness but was threatened all the time to be in the shadows of, you know, remaining in the shadows of the another popular dance form. So that threatening is what actually was, for a long time, there was a struggle between, you know, the connoisseurs, scholars and performers and gurus to understand how to, you know, develop this form without being that, you know, having many of these deterrents.
Right.
But now, of course, I think things have sorted out. In 2018, the Sangeet Natak Academy Delhi had organized a national seminar on Kaishiki Vritti. And this Kaishiki Vritti meant that Mohiniyattam is a, this Kaishiki Vritti is a term synonym with Mohiniyattam. So every dancer, whether established, whether leading performing artists, gurus of Kalamandla outside, where you had Srimad Dr. Kanakarede also, Padma Bhushan, who was there. She was the main, one of the main guests, I would say the acharyas, who was there at that time. And you had Padma Shri Bharati Shivaji. She also had has developed a distinct style. All these people had come together. There were, I think, more than 35 to 45 participants as gurus, performers and musicians. They all came under together and we had a wonderful two-day seminar which was very fruitful, with everybody coming to a conclusion, a decision, that whatever movement and expression that suited Mohiniyattam and that was conducive to its development and popularity and sustenance in the future, coming future, should be accepted and adopted in the style. So there was nothing like a hardcore tradition or nothing like a hardcore orthodoxy around which you had to remain. You could expand within the given format of what your guru taught or what your sampradaya taught you. Within that format, you can expand. There is a possibility.
Right.
So this was a good achievement, I think, because I was the main coordinator of that, and I was very fortunate that all these performers could come and contribute.
Well, it's actually beautiful you say that, because even when you look at the time when Maharaja Swami Pinnal would have got this, maybe along with the help of the Tanjore Quartet and everybody, he tried to get this entire art form revived during his time of Mohiniyattam, and he composed the padams and other things for Mohiniyattam. So for somebody like a Kalyani Kutty Amma, during her time, then there was no, of course, you did have the tradition, as you rightly said, in fragmented form, because there was no live tradition or a live institution taking it ahead at her time.
Right.
So she also would have had her own ways to link it up, right, on seeing somebody performing some adagos, trying to say whether this makes sense to, you know, bring it into a stage performance.
Yes.
So she would have done her own research in terms of bringing a structure to this entire.
You see, if you read her book, when, as I said, as I grew mature as a dancer, when I started choreographing all the research compositions that I, along with my mother, Lee Dong Cherry, whatever genres or musical forms or compositions we could unearth, before I ventured into choreography, I first tried to understand what was the analysis, what was the basis of the analysis of Kalyani Kutty Amma. So I read her book on Mohiniyattam, and in that I understood for the first time that she really struggled to understand what are the movements that could be adopted into this style. And I am told that when I interacted with her daughter, Srimati Kala Vigyan, she used to say that for hours she would walk, because there would be no conveyance. From hours she would walk down, because somebody would tell her there is one small little place where house where a particular dancer, probably who was dancing Mohiniyattam, would be there, is there, so why don't you interact? So she would go to those places only to come to know that they themselves had no idea what kind of a form it was, a style. So she had had a lot of failures in her her journey, her attempt to understand the style, but yet with all the performers during that time, the great scholars, M.K.K. Nair, he was one of the greatest promoters of Kerala art forms, Kathakali and Mohiniyattam. We owe a lot to him, actually. M.K.K. Nair, Sri M.K.K. Nair, she interacted with people like him, connoisseurs, and also some musicians. She used to say Fiddle Padmavati. I mean, I don't know much about her, but she used to always say Fiddlist Padmavati, she would always say. These are the people who had some idea about what the style was, apparently. Mm. And then she, belonging to the Tripuritara region, because she came from there, there was a temple there where till, I think, almost 20th century, they were dancers. They were Dasi dancers who were still performing in that temple. So, and her reading of several texts, including Natyashastra, she could understand, and she devised her own terms, like instead of karanas, charis, bramaris, we have all these terminologies in Natyashastra. Yeah. Based on that, she developed, she could not actually per se bring and copy it and keep it and add to Mohiniyattam. So she gave her own terminology. Like for instance, we today, all the Mohiniyattam dancers know about the five kind of Pada Gatigal. It is not Pada Vedas or Sanakas, it is Gatigal. She termed it as Pada Gatigal. These are the Nagabandham, Sarpapadam, like a snake, which is a very typical movement of Mohiniyattam.
Right.
Then Mandukapadam, like a frog's leaf. Then Kukudapadam, the cock's leaf. The movement of the cock. Then you have Mayura Padam, Hamsa Padam. She gave these five Pada Gatigal to these movements, which are very commonly adopted in movements of Mohiniyattam. Similarly, she had, instead of Drishti Bhedas, which Natyashastra has in it, she gave it as Darshana Bhedas, because she felt there were many expressions that, even though they had some conformity with what Natyashastra speaks, but in the expression, the manner of expression, it differed. So when it differed, you could not actually per se give the same terminology. You have to give us different terminology and also say which is closer to that terminology. Now, if you find, if you look at other dance forms like Odissi, Kathak, you will find that they have their own terminologies. Mm. But these terminologies have been interpreted perhaps differently in Natyashastra and other important texts on Nritya. But they have their own terminologies. So like that, Mohiniyattam also, she gave a terminology for us, people, students and disciples who wanted to understand. For them, it was easy to understand. Like the movement of the hand, the movement of the feet. She would say one-fourth movement, half movement, three-fourth. And so she would say ara, kal, ara, bukal, buru. You know, she would give those terminologies, and immediately that image comes to your mind, your eyes in front of you. Okay, ara, kal, bukal. So everything was based on logic. And that is what I found gave me that push or input to choreograph and move ahead with my compositions.
Amazing, ma'am, amazing. I think when you hear such stories about, especially about Kalyanakutty Amma, who single-handedly, of course, as you rightly said, there were many people to support her, but still to revive an art form which doesn't have a living tradition, which is so vibrant, right? To recreate the whole thing is very difficult. And I think we owe to her what we have Mohiniyattam today. I mean, in terms of the music that is used in Mohiniyattam, of course, we know of the Swati Padams, which she composed in the Nayika, Nayaka Bhava. You know of those. Apart from the Swati Padams, what are the typical compositions that are used for Mohiniyattam, the typical ragams and talams that are used in Mohiniyattam?
See, now, I would say here, Padma Bhushan, Sri Kavalam Narayana Padikarji, and my mother, both, and others also, they were scholars also, musicians and scholars, they were responsible for bringing sopana music into Mohiniyattam, which till then was not introduced, because we lost that sopana tradition once after the decline of Mohiniyattam. Because till Swati Tirunal's period, there is when I used to interact with Kavalam Narayan Panditji, he was like I would say he knew me from my childhood, so he was very close I would say in association with my parents, very closely connected with my parents. So when I used to interact with him, he used to say that even during Swati Tirunal's period, the court sampradaya, darbar sampradaya, the music there which was adopted had a tinge of sopana sangeeta. It was not purely classical, because that was the time when there was a change in the mode pattern of Kerala sangeetam. So even though there was an influence of Carnatic sangeetam into the Kerala sangeetam, but it had really not completely dominated that. Unfortunately, it was during the revival period that Carnatic music had completely taken over many of the art forms, because Uttaram Tirunal, who promoted and propagated after Swati Kathakali, Kathakali could still retain the sopana tradition because it had the patronage. There was no period of decline for Kathakali. It remained secured in the temples and temple premises. But Mohiniyattam did not have the same fate. So when Carnatic music came into its repertoire, that is when we had lost a very valuable music exponent, music component. Now when Kavalam Narayan Panditji, my mother, when they all brought back the sopana tradition, its analysis and musical compositions, it was essential for them to introduce that into the Mohiniyattam. And that is where when the Mohiniyattam, the soft flowing graceful style of singing, which is very different from Carnatic music, when that entered, the Mohiniyattam repertoire also changed to suit it. So there were many musical forms, many compositions which were existing in the region of Kerala that was introduced into Mohiniyattam repertoire, besides the Padam and Padavarnams, which were there, which had the Carnatic ragas and talas, but they were there. But apart from that, these other musical forms were also introduced. So for instance, I'll tell you the compositions that I and my mother along with her.
Right.
There is a Padam which is composed by Remintam. Now this is something in 1980 when we published our Abhinya Sangeetam, nobody knew about this composition, because this is one Padam which is set to Talamalika. The Pallavi is in Chatushra Eka, Anupallavi is in Rupakam, and the Charanam is in Chaputala. And the Chaputala has a Sroto Vahayati. It is so beautifully, the words are sight is so beautifully entwined into the melodic phrases.
So ma'am, when you say Sroto Vahayati, you're actually saying that the letters keep on increasing, is it? With
every Yentu cheyendu nyaayiyo inni chunnadum kuiyo. Yentu cheyendu nyaayiyo inni chunnadum. This comes in Chatushrekam. This is the Anupali. Sutati tavarati katuti mugu ಪತಿ ಸಪತಿ ನಿಜಿಡಮಿನ್ನು ಎಂದು ಚೇಂದು See how beautifully whoever has composed it, Iremin Tambi, how beautifully that sahitya and musical phrases are combined.
Correct, correct. And also, ma'am, it goes with the lyrics. So in the charanam, yeah, he's introducing one adjective and one word after the other.
Sutati tavarati, it is a srotava. Sutati tavarati karuti mukurapi. Then it expands a little more. So it's expansive. So that's the strut of identity.
Right. And also, ma'am, when you look at, as you rightly said, for that lasyam which Mohiniyattam has, without those rigid movements which you see in a Bharatanatyam or something, the sopana is many times the most suited, along with the edakka. When you hear the sopana, you can even picture is a Mohiniyattam in front of you most of the times, right?
Yes.
Even from a natural perspective, there is a flair for each other.
Yes. For instance, you see, there is a Nritya Prabandham which I do, which again is a research composition. It is in Guru Champa. Guru Champa means if you take the Karnataka Sangeetam, Tala, Sula, the Saptataras, you will never, except for of course Rupakam, you have a starting from Drutam and Lagu.
Yeah.
Most of the talas start with laku. They don't have a starting from a reach or a beat, right? So here, this Guru Champa has a drutam followed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 laku and another laku 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
So this is a 10 Akshara Tala Guru Champa. So Anupama Kali Baran Atalankan Mama Kantan Anayuban Yende So you see that flow and the Guru Champa Talam, it goes with, along with the Sahitya.
And also, ma'am, I've seen, especially when you mentioned about these different structures of the Talam, I think it seems to be very indigenous to the art forms of Kerala, because even when you sing the Kathakali music, it's all up and down, right? You have to keep on singing with the actor, you know, you elongate it many places, you go on repeating many times, sometimes you shorten it. So it is a very closely knit form. I think it's quite indigenous to the Kerala forms.
See, that is, you have actually touched upon the correct, the essence of Kerala music. Kerala arts and Kerala music, basically, especially those which are connected to the temple, especially those, they are all based on the concept of Kauratrikam, which is a concept that was in existence much before the Sulavi Saptatalas came into being. So if you see the Sangeet Ratnakara and so many other granthas that came before, first I think we get a clarity of that Kauratrika aspect in Sangeet Ratnakara, 13th century. Now in that, the Sangeetam term meant ki गीतं वाद्यं नृत्यं त्रयं संगीतम् उच्यते. दैट मीन्स द टर्म संगीत म्यूजिक इंक्लूडेड गीतं वाद्यं नृत्यं. सो the tradition in Kerala, if you see, as you rightly have observed, that Kathakali Sangeetam adopts the concept of Tavratrika, where the singer is not concentrating or focusing on his melodic output, but he is actually focusing on how best the dramatic impact from that particular movement can be brought about. So he emphasizes with a particular emphasis of a note or a musical phrase for when the actor is enacting that particular scene, right? So he's actually enacting while he's singing.
Yeah.
So the singer personifies the concept of Tavratrika. And right, this is the speciality of Kerala music, Kerala art forms, which you will find is very, very explicit in Kathakali.
Yes, absolutely. And you can also, because this is the essence you get when you hear that music itself, that it is not bound by any of the typical tala structures. It is a bit free flowing at times, and it again comes into a structure. So there is some kind of a flow that keeps on happening in this entire structure when you hear the music. Yes. And also, you spoke about the Sopana Sangeetam. Like I had heard that majorly Ashtapadi used to be sung in those days in Sopana Sangeetam, the early days. But were there later compositions also composed for Sopana Sangeetam?
I would say here the Ashtapadi singing came only with the advent of Geeta Govinda into the state of Kerala.
Yeah.
That is, I would say, in the 13th century, when the Vaishnava saints brought in the Geeta Govinda from Odisha. Now, before that, the music in the temples were very, very rigid and only concerned with the rituals that were conducted in the temple. So there was no question of a Madhura Bhakti concept coming into the temple music there at all. So you will find that rigidity of expressions, the bhavas in music, suddenly took a turn to Madhura Bhakti Bhava with the advent of Geeta Govinda. When the Geeta Govinda came, along with it came the Ashtapadi. It is from that time which people readily accepted, because there was a sweet melody concept through which you could worship God. So this was, for the people of Kerala, it was something, a new-founded expression of bhakti,
yeah.
So which they readily adopted. And so the Ashtapadi became an important part of the Sopana Kottipadi Seva. The Kottipadi Seva means where the singer stood near the sanctum, steps of the sanctum, played the adagya while he sang the dhyana shlokas, dhyanis, and other, whatever devotional songs that he was to sing. And Sopana songs, the Ashtapadis, was an important integral part of that Kottipadi Seva. Now, when Mohiniyattam was being revived, the Sopana Ashtapadis also became an important integral part of Mohiniyattam. And I would say here that in Kerala, based on Sopana Ashtapadis, there were some other compositions which were stylized, formatted in similar manner, like Bhasha Ashtapadi, Shiva Ashtapadi. These were all composed by the Kerala composers. Some of the compositions are very highly poetical, literary has with values, these Bhasha Ashtapadis, but the Bhasha Ashtapadi is something very colloquial. It has Malayalam and it has Sanskrit. So some composers must have composed it because they also wanted to have something like an Ashtapadi manner. And I, along with my mother, could unearth a Bhasha Ashtapadi like that, through an oral tradition by a great veteran musician from Kerala who taught this Bhasha Ashtapadi. He Sakira De Shrinu Me. It is like based on the Ashtapadi of Jayadeva. This is in Malayalam, which I have performed.
Also, I think the greatness of bringing Sopana Sangeetam to Mohiniyattam was also that the ragas of Sopana Sangeetam also would have entered into Mohiniyattam then. which there are many others we identify, which is very typical to Sopana Sangeetam or Kerala music, which was not there in Carnatic music, right?
Yes, yes. Here I would say there has posed certain challenges, because okay. not all ragas have been explored fully, which you can call as Sopana ragas, have been actually explored fully in Kerala music. If you take Kudiyattam, you will find a lot of these ragas are mentioned there, but these ragas are barely tunes, which are, I wouldn't even say tunes, but they are musical phrases. They are just musical phrases with just a couple of notes revolve around which you revolve certain phrases to bring that impact, the dramatic impact required for that situation. Now, when you adopt them in an art form or a style like Moyniyattam, where Sanchari Bhavas, improvisation has to be immense, there it can pose a lot of challenges. So, till now, Moyniyattam has adopted only those ragas which have been fully explored. And these ragas, you will find many of them are there in Kathakali today. That have been there, like Paadi, Puraneera, Dukkha Khandaram. You know, all these ragas have been taken and fully adopted in Moyniyattam. But ragas like Nalatta, even Tukka Ragam, which I have taken in one of the Nritya Prabandhams, which has been composed. Actually, my mother has composed and scripted that, melodically scripted. It is in Tukka Ragam. We were able to explore and expand that only because Tukka has some reflection of Durga. You know, our Shuddha Sadhini. It has that reflection. So certain, based on certain compositions, based set to Tukka Ragam in the Kerala music, we could understand the musical phrases that could be adopted in this Nritya Prabandham. So that is how we have been able to develop that. Now, it is for the musicians, the Sopana musicians, to now work on that in tandem with the Moyniyattam dancers and do the best, you know, to enhance the form.
Absolutely, ma'am. And also the themes that we use for Moyniyattam, like of course the typical dance dramas or theatrical forms in India have typically taken from the Puranic stories or itihasas. So when you take up Moyniyattam, what have been the primary themes that were used? And if you look at it today, is it more open now to take up contemporary themes when you perform? How do you, has it opened up now to more themes?
Yes, of course. You see, for any art form to sustain and revive and flourish, it requires, it has to go with the flow of the that particular period and the demand of the society. It has to have that. If it does not follow, unless it is protected and patronized in a particular environment, it will not survive. Kudiyattam could survive because it was within the closed and walls of the temple, and only the temple dwellers performed that. So it survived. But for Moyniyattam to survive, it has to get into those molds which changes from time to time. It has to. Right. But what is important here, and honestly, I have not explored there. I have not ventured into those thematic productions, presentations, and I have not explored. Because I think I can contribute better towards what is belonging to the region, which needs to be unearthed, and where I can still I can continue to explore and find the possibilities in the rhythmic aspect, in the melodic aspect, in the compositional aspect. That is where my work is all revolved around that. Finding that out, I try to incorporate and choreograph and present. So I have not really ventured into these thematic productions, which I have seen many of the dancers of the present times have done it very beautifully. And they have, that is why it has reached that global level of popularity also. But my aim is that since I have a Carnatic music, I learned Carnatic music from Pallavi Vidwan, D.S. Raghavan, who was a Pallavi exponent, Ragantana Pallavi exponent. Vidwan Sangeeta Kalanidhi, T.R. Subramaniam sir was my guru when I was learning, doing my graduation, post-graduation at university. Then I had Srimati Akhila Krishnan, who was the daughter of the legendary Veero Vishwanath Iyer. He taught me the melodic aspect, how to explore the expand the melodic ragas, the melody in the raga. All this gave me made me to decide that I should work on the music aspect. So, for instance, I've taken the talas from the different percussions, different the Kerala art forms, dance forms like Arjuna Nrityam, Maithili Kutram, then Maddalam, Idakya. All these I've tried to take. See, for instance, I will just recite. This is a Vaitari. This is a syllable that I've taken from Maddalam Vidwan, Maddala Shankara Varya Rasha. Of course, he has recorded an entire galaxy of this rhythmic variation, but I've tried to take that because I've recently choreographed for that dance. So, let us take it, if you can put it in any tala, but I'm taking it in Chatusha Eka, which is the simplest one. Arjuna Nrityam Maithili Thukkam, which I took from Kurchi Kumar Nayarasham. He was a legend. He used to recite one tala from mouth. One hand would be one tala, another hand would be another tala, the right foot would be another tala, the left would be another. Now, all these, because they would be multiples of one tala, towards the end of the dance performance, it would come and, you know, blend with each other. I recorded few Vaitaris from him also. I have tried to incorporate that in one of the Nritya Prabandhams, between a fight between the Kaliya and the serpent and the Krishna and Kaliya, the fight between them. So that is how I have tried to incorporate. Of course, I had to somehow, you know, do certain combinations here and there and fit into it. If you see, watch my, on the YouTube, I have recorded this item. I have used the Veena for both showing the expressions of the Bhava, and I tried to use the rhythm by these, adding these sort of syllables and shoulder into, you know, that movement. So these are the areas where I have really tried to work out, and I'm continuing. I'm still learning from great veterans like Kalle Kulangara Achutan Kutimara. He's my guru actually in understanding the temple rhythms which are exclusive to the region of temple music. He's my guru there. With him I started interacting way back from 1995, and he was the one who gave me lot of Idakya Kuru, which we call Kuru, is a kind of what you call as in harmony Kuru, you know, which comes as a culmination between sections. So he recorded a lot of such Kurus for me way back in 1995, and I'm very grateful to have people like him, Neleshwara Shankara Maharan Ashan, who of course has passed away. He was one of the temple maram players, which, you know, these are temple rituals where the playing drumming is to only accompany the rituals, and you cannot deviate from the particular manner in which the rhythm has been set. So, because it can have an ill effect on you, there can be ill omen. So, he was one of the big ones. He was one of the veteran players of Maram. And there I and my mother both went and met him and spoke to him and all that. So, like that, there were many people with whom we had interactions. And I would like to say here that, you see, I was very fortunate, I would like to say, that I had great gurus, that I consider myself blessed. Whether it was Kathakali, whether it was Kalyanakutti Amma, Mohiniyattam, whether it was my parents who hailed from the region which was rich in Kerala. My mother hailed from Kanyakumari district, which was once belonged to the capital of the Travancore Marathas. So she got valuable information about music and the music culture there. My father, who hails from Vakyam, there is a Vakyam Kshetra Kala Peetham in the Vakyam Kshetra there. We got a lot of inputs from great veteran artists who were there. So these were certain, I would say, blessings that I had, which I could have.
Absolutely. As we earlier said, because Kerala, each one is intertwined into the other. The music goes into the dance goes into the dance form, the theatre, and everything is all mixed. Unless you have each of these aspects woven, it doesn't come. I mean, in terms of the musical instruments, do you restrict it to the indigenous instruments of Kerala only, or do you also adopt the mridangam or kyatam, and other instruments are also taken into a Mohiniyattam performance?
Yeah, that's another very important question that you have asked. You see, when Mohiniyattam, when it was, there were certain innovations that were taking place in developing Mohiniyattam. That time they had introduced Maddalam. Edakya was always a part of Mohiniyattam, but apart from Edakya, I'm told that there were certain other instruments also. Toppi Maddalam, Tutti, Shankham, Edakya, these were part of the Mohiniyattam orchestral accompaniment. These were the accompanying instruments for Mohiniyattam. I was told that by Kalyanakutti Amma. So probably this was in existence during its revival period. But gradually they realized that the repertoire being very similar to which had already been influenced by Carnatic music, they took up mridangam was better suited to play those rhythmic patterns. You know, it was a better suited instrument. So when there was a changeover to Maddalam also being included into Mohiniyattam, which I would say is an excellent introduction to Mohiniyattam, inclusion I would say in its accompaniment, because the nritta aspect can certainly be enhanced by the Maddalam. If you are basing your performance to purely sopana talas, the mandalam is the most ideally suited instrument for sopana talas. But if you are performing a padam, padavarnam, jatiswaram or something like that, which has a Carnatic music tala, mridangam is better suited for that. You cannot have that in the mandalam. So what I decided was that I could not take all the three instruments, Edakya, Maddalam and Mridangam, with my performance wherever I perform. It was too expensive for me to do that.
Right.
So what I decided was that all the Vaitaris that I had unearthed from and understood and adopted into Mohiniyattam, the Kerala Vaitaris, the Mridangam has now started playing those Vaitaris. So when it comes to performing the padam or the padavarnam or something like that, which is purely based on Carnatic music, the mridangam uses its own rhythmic accompaniment. And when I'm doing an item which has more of sopana talas, the mridangam adopts those talas in its playing technique. That is one thing that I have tried to include, because I would be very honest that mridangam has a tonal quality which maddalam lacks. Maddalam is very suited for Kathakali, which is a slightly louder, has a louder impact, which needs that loud instrumental accompaniment.
Correct.
So unless you softly and subtly use that instrument, it can be deterrent to a very subtle and very sensitive expression of a bhava when you are doing. So there, the mridangam and edakya have a very, very important role to play. So that is one of the reasons that I continue to adopt mridangam, though I very much am in favor of matalam also when you are performing.
No, ma'am, I think what you said makes a lot of sense, because as you rightly said, it's a very lasya-oriented dance form, which has got more of lasya element in it. So the mridangam is even more subtler and softer, which can adapt to that kind of this one. At the same time, having the edakka, it helps in the sopana sangeetam, that flow, which the mridangam may not be able to give, that flow, which the edakka will give at many times, the reverberation of the music.
In fact, the edakya player who plays for me, he is perhaps the only edakya player, I would say, in Kerala, I mean, as an accompanist for Mohiniyattam. He would perhaps be the only player I know who plays all the vaitharis that madalam or I can do. I have introduced him in the past. He plays not only the bhava, but he also learns all the vaitharis himself. So if you find, when you see my video recordings or my performance, you will find both edakya and mridangam, they play the vaitharis together. So edakya I do not use only exclusively for my portrayal of abhinaya, no. It also is used for my expression of dhita and
dhita.
So it is how you are actually using your accompanying artists. It's how you use those instruments, how best you can have.
Absolutely, ma'am. And also, if you look at the costumes that you typically use in the Mohiniyattam, I have many times felt that there is a restriction, right? Like you have a particular costume which is generally there for the Mohiniyattam performance. So when you do this kind of, when somebody does a thematic or any such kind of things, is there some kind of leeway allowed in the costumes that can be used, or they still have to maintain that costumes all through?
There I would say that I agree with many dancers when they change the costume to suit, that you find even in Bharatanatyam today. Many of the dancers who are using a thematic kind of a presentation, they do change their costume to suit that theme, particular theme that they are trying to portray. And today, you know, a Bharatanatyam or a Kuchipudi or these recitals will not have a margam. It's all based on themes. So a 1.5 hour concert or a 2 hour concert will be based on a particular theme of a Devi or a Krishna or something like that. And around which, whatever compositions that you can get, whatever themes, you are trying to choreograph and present. That's how it goes in today's time.
Right.
So in that case, in Mohiniyattam, if it is a thematic performance, I think to suit that particular theme, to symbolize something, you can use a, you know, like a feather, you try to symbolize Krishna. So you can symbolize with something in your costume that depicts that, symbolizes that. But when you are doing a margam, when it is a pure classical performance of Mohiniyattam, I continue to adhere. I can't say about others, but I continue to adhere even today the simple costume and the jewelry that Kalyani Kuti Amma insisted the dancers should wear, so that the spectators are glued to your face and expressions and movements and not distracted by your over glamorous or overdone aharya. So that is something I feel one has to pay a little more, be a little more sensitive to that.
Right. Well, as you now look at, like you have learned from such a great guru, and as you rightly mentioned, from such great gurus, you know, who have each of their art has influenced you in different ways. Now, as you pass this on to the next generation, how do you see the interest, enthusiasm for them to take the tradition as it is? And do you face any challenges when you pass this on to the next generation?
Yes, here I would say that. I don't know how to react to this question, but to be very honest, in today's time, a dancer is learning more than one art form. It's not like my generation where you had to complete a training of 8 years, 12 years, or whatever, and you gave a complete lifetime to learning and performing and understanding an art form. Today, it's not so. A young dancer who wants to establish herself as a good dancer, she's academically, of course, she's much well read than her predecessors. And she wants to learn Kuchipudi, she wants to learn Bharatanatyam, she wants to learn Mohiniyattam, Kathakali, everything together. And she, after having learned that, she tries to present a performance, she tries to give a performance. So, this is a big challenge I face, because obviously many of my students, though I do not teach any other dance form except Mohiniyattam, like there might be some teachers who might be teaching other than Mohiniyattam also. They are teaching Bharatanatyam, they may be teaching Kathakali or something else, I mean whatever. I have been from the start till the end, it is only Mohiniyattam. Whoever comes to me only learns Mohiniyattam, only learns the compositions and how to sing those compositions. They may or may not learn Carnatic music, but at least they should know how to put the tala and they should know how to sing. They should know the word meaning of what they are singing, I mean what they are performing. So these students who come to me, some of them are also learning Kathakali. Some of them, most of them are learning Kathakali. Now why I do not object to that is, because learning Kathakali is what I did also before I ventured into Mohiniyattam. And it is a very closer art form to Mohiniyattam.
Correct.
So it will enhance, it will help them to understand the distinction and the difference between the two art forms.
Right.
So I let them do that. But sometimes it does reflect when they perform that overexpression does come in their, that subtlety, they sometimes overlook. But on the whole, I find if it is something, an art form which is particular to that region, if you learn that, then I think it will be conducive to the development of that style you want to perform. You want to, you know, establish yourself. Rather than learning a style which is completely opposite, in conflicting or conflict with what you, the style that you want to, you know, pursue. So there you have to be very, very sensitive.
Absolutely. I'm great, ma'am. I didn't know how the last 1 hour went by, because I still feel there is much more to talk to you. There is much more that the discussion has to go, and especially on your musical part, though we did touch upon it in the middle, I feel there is much more discussion on the music itself, just without the dance form, on the music itself. So probably we should have a discussion in the future, ma'am. I'm really looking forward to another discussion purely on music. But I think this was a fantastic discussion I had, ma'am. I really enjoyed. And from the comments I'm getting, I'm sure all the Rasikas have also enjoyed this interaction. And thanks a lot, ma'am. I couldn't have asked for more for the 25th session of the series. I couldn't have asked for more. That I have such a great artist who's come from such great. And the name of the series is, ma'am, the Pandev Guru Paramparam series. So this is the Guru Shishya tradition. And what more to ask for? You come from such great traditions. You yourself are now taking it up to the next level. So I am really thankful to you, ma'am, for this interaction. Thanks a lot for this.
Thank you, Subbu. You asked some very wonderful and pertinent questions, and I hope my answers have been satisfied. And answers have satisfied to some extent what probably the dancers would like to know. So thank you very much for asking.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you. So, Rasikas, as you saw, this 25th session, I couldn't have asked for more. Actually, the mother of Dr. Deepthi, Dr. Veera Omcheri, is a great musicologist, a music scholar herself. And of course, Kalamandalam Kalyanakutti Amma, from which tradition Dr. Deepthi comes. So, such a great bearer of this tradition, and now she's taking it up to the next generation. So I hope all of you enjoyed this. So this series continues. So until we come up with the next Sambhashana series, keep watching the videos on Subbu's Corner on both the FB page as well as the YouTube channel. Till the next session comes up, Namaskar.